Welcome back, everyone. I'm Tanya Fitzpatrick, one half of the award-winning podcast, World Footprints. The other half is right behind me. It's my husband, Ian. And I'm here today with another friend, Barbara Marrett. And Barb and I actually serve on the advisory board for the North America Travel Journalists Association. And she represents San Juan Islands. And I'm not talking San Juan, Puerto Rico. That's what everyone knows San Juan for. But there's a beautiful gem, a hidden gem, really, off the west coast of Washington State called San Juan Islands. And so I wanted to invite Barb to join me tonight and talk a little bit about what's going on in Washington on the islands. Particularly, we've all heard about the episodes in Seattle, and also share just the beauty of the islands. So Barb, thank you for joining us on World Footprints.
Thank you. This is the most fun conference I've had all day. This is my fifth. So I hope I make sense. So the San Juan Islands are, they're in the Salish Sea, so they're very protected. We are in between Vancouver Island and the mainland of the U.S., and you get here by ferry. So we have no bridges. We're kind of isolated, which is great in a lot of situations. It has its challenges in others. So we're in a really interesting spot in light of the virus.
Mm-hmm. And speaking of which, has there been much impact on the islands? Because, you know, you're close to Seattle, and we all know what happened in Seattle. What's been the impact on the islands?
Well, you know, in terms of the virus itself, we only have 6 confirmed cases, but we suspect there are a lot more out there. We haven't been able to do a lot of testing. Like many small communities, we haven't been able to get the supplies to do testing. So we've been super careful about inviting people here. Our governor has basically closed the state to any unnecessary travel. So that goes for the islands. We are not inviting visitors. Our lodgings are just open for essential workers. And so we're trying to keep safe here. And we expect that things won't peak here for several more weeks. And it's had a really big, we've taken a big hit. Our tourism industry has taken a big hit because we are beautiful islands. We rely very heavily on visitors for our economy. And so with virtually everything but essential businesses closed, it's taking a really big economic hit on the islands.
And you're getting ready to enter into your peak season, you know, with the warmer months, especially.
Right. So our busiest months are July, August, and September. And we're hoping that this will have passed through by then. And that we'll get, you know, those visitors coming. We also have something called Savor the San Juans in October, which I think will be great timing for people to visit. So we're hoping to salvage a bit of the season. Mm-hmm. In a way, it's a blessing that it came here as early as it did, although, you know, we're not seeing the same impacts as Seattle. And because our governor was so proactive, we're flattening the curve. Mm-hmm. He's doing a really great job being cautious.
Now, with in Washington and on the islands themselves, do you have any concerns or any challenges with medical facilities and medical supplies as we are particularly on the East Coast here?
Absolutely, we do. We have a hospital on the main island, which is San Juan Island. It only has 10 beds. And any serious medical emergencies on the island get flown off the island. So we have had, so far, no hospitalizations. People have just been quarantining at home. But, you know, if mainland hospitals fill up with virus patients, there'll be no place for our folks to go. So there have been contingencies made. If we get to the point then that our hospital beds are full on San Juan Island, the other islands have clinics, but our emergency team has made provisions for, you know, creating hospitals or accommodating people where they might have to. So there's a scenario where people need to be quarantined from their family. So they talk to some of the hoteliers about putting up those family members. And what's really wonderful is that our community is small and tight-knit. So a lot of retired first responders, nurses and doctors have stepped up to help should they need it. So that's really wonderful.
Bless. Now, I want to ask you, because San Juan Islands, I read, encompasses 172 islands, but I know all of those are not inhabited. And so how many islands are we talking about that are affected by this virus?
Well, we have cases, confirmed cases on three of the islands. So most of the 172 islands are very tiny little islands. They're reefs and rocks. So we only have four islands that are served by the ferry, and only three of those have visitor amenities. So there are people living in the outer islands, and I suspect that they'll be safe if they don't have friends or family visit. Mm-hmm. And they're, this time of year, there's really virtually no tourism out there. We've had a challenge, as many beautiful places like ours do, where there are a lot of vacation homes. So people have come from the city to their vacation homes to shelter here instead of the city, which we've been trying to discourage because our governor is like, stay in place, stay in your primary home.
Right, because they're still interacting with locals. They go to the market and...
Exactly. Mm-hmm. Yeah, some of our markets, you know, there's certain shelves that are bare. The canned soup is gone. So not only is there the potential of them bringing the virus with them, they're also using up supplies. And we're sort of at the end of the food chain. So we're not being able to restock our shelves very quickly. I mean, we haven't run out of food by any means, but there are just certain things you can't get, like dry cat food is really hard to find right now.
Who would have thought? Dry cat food? What about your toilet paper? Are people hoarding that too?
Oh, absolutely. Toilet paper is like, they were rationing it one roll per person.
Oh my goodness.
Yeah, exactly.
So you mentioned that a lot of people are coming out of retirement, first responders, medical professionals. What are some of the other things that neighbors on these small islands are doing to help one another?
Well, I'm sure there's, you know, probably hundreds of stories out there because we are islands, we have to be more self-reliant, especially people on the non-ferry served islands. But neighbors are buying groceries for neighbors. We had friends from an outer island come to buy their groceries, and there was no place for them to eat in town at that point. Now things have changed a bit. We have, our restaurants are open for takeout and grab and go. You can't sit down. So we had them over for dinner. We did our virtual hugs and we were very careful. But yeah, I'm buying groceries for my elderly neighbor. Our animal shelter has asked the community to foster some of the pets that haven't been adopted. So that's been going on. Residents have been paying rent for their neighbors who can't afford it. And utilities are postponing utility bills and disconnects. So if people aren't able to pay their utility bills, their power is not going to be shut off. The whole community is really trying to stretch in a way to create a safety net for their neighbors, because as I said, so many people are involved in the tourism industry directly and indirectly. We have islanders who are with sewing skills who are making masks for first responders and each other, because we've had a really hard time getting masks. There are a lot of really fun online classes. There's one facility has made these little art kits for kids and they're giving them away free. They went to the recycle center and got pieces from there, and then they're giving online classes. There's a gal who's doing an online boxing class. Our like local...
Like fist boxing?
Yeah, like
fist boxing. Oh, wow.
Yeah. So there's, you know, we've been aggregating all this stuff at the Visitors Bureau to just send out and put a smile on people's faces. There's a company here that makes filters that go into outer space, and they are in the midst of converting their facility to making masks. So yeah, there's the islands are known for their artistic feel and their creativity, and people are really stepping up.
I'd say that some of the online classes, are they open to people off the island or other?
Yeah, I don't see why not. They're free and they're asking for donations.
Okay.
Yeah, there's a nonprofit called the Sea Doc Society, and they do research in the Salish Sea, and they've put together a whole web program for kids for science that's just wonderful.
Sea Doc, D-O-C?
Yes, S-E-A-D-O-C Society. And yeah, anyone, I don't see why anyone in the country who has bored kids wouldn't enjoy taking one of these classes. His principal's name is Joe Gatos, or the director, and his kids helped him put together these classes. So
I'm sure
they'll appeal to kids.
That's wonderful.
Right.
So other than the boxing class, which I don't know if you're doing, but how do you de-stress? I mean, what are you doing to kind of relieve anxiety, to kind of stay centered? Boxing would be a really great thing.
Yeah. Well, I've been trying to every morning get up and do about 10 minutes of stretching, like yoga stretching. And I've been trying to stay in a routine. And then at lunchtime, I've been going for a 10-minute walk, you know, during my lunch break. And then after work, I've been trying to go for a walk too, and then do the stretching at night. But I have to say, it's been pretty stressful because, you know, at our Visitors Bureau, our job is to attract people to the islands. And so right now we're asking people to stay away, but we're also giving them reasons to dream about coming in the future. So it's a whole shift. We've also been really trying to engage with our local community to let everyone know all the programs that are available, all the financial help that's available. You know, our community foundations are getting donations to help some of our nonprofits. We're fortunate in that we have some wealthy residents on the island who can help. Mm-hmm. But most people who are working here have two or three jobs. So there's quite a disparity in the income levels on the island.
Mm-hmm. Well, let's talk about some of those reasons people should come to San Juan Islands after this pandemic is lifted and we all have our freedom back.
Right. Well, we have something called Island Time. And actually, if people want to participate, we have a campaign going on with a hashtag San Juan Islands Challenge. And if they want to post something on their social media, on Instagram or Facebook, of how they're experiencing island time at home, because you can experience it anytime. Island time is really slowing down and, you know, taking time to enjoy nature or bike or hike or kayak or do those kind of things. We would love to hear from folks from around the country. So that's hashtag San Juan Islands Challenge. You know, it's a much slower pace. It's relaxed. People are friendly. People don't tend to lock their cars or their houses. There's very little crime on the island. So if you're a family and you want a safe place to come, and not worry about your kids like running off on the trail or something like that. It's great. We say it's nature's theme park, right? Mm-hmm. So there's, in the spring, the eagles are mating. We have more nesting bald eagles than any other place in the lower 48. The eagles are nesting, there are fox kits. You can see whales from shore, or if your heart is set on seeing whales, you can take a whale watch tour. There's otters. There's just a lot of wonderful wildlife here that people come to view. And then, of course, there's kayaking. And when you kayak, you often see, you know, seabirds, bald eagles. You may see dolphins, whales.
Well, it sounds like, you know, for anyone wanting to de-stress the San Juan Islands, really right now would be ideal, but we don't want anyone to come right now.
No, for obvious reasons. But we will roll out the red carpet when it's safe to do so. And we will really, really welcome visitors, because I know a lot of people are suffering right now, and it's just been 2 weeks, and it sounds like the governor's going to extend, you know, the non-essential travel a bit longer, just so we can really get rid of this virus as soon as possible.
Mm-hmm. Well, Barbara, I thank you so much for spending time with us, for sharing what's happening on the islands, on the west coast of the United States. And I hope that Ian and I are some of the first visitors to come post-pandemic.
Oh, we would love to have you. Thank you so much. It's just been fun to connect with you and even to see Ian in the background there. So yes, Save the San Juans in the fall is a really wonderful time. We have film festivals, farm tours, and just we celebrate the bounty of the island. So thank you so much, Tanya.
It's my pleasure.